Said the little lamb to the shepherd boy, do you hear what I hear? Ringing through the sky, shepherd boy, do you hear what I hear? A song, high above the trees, with a voice as big as the sea. With a voice as big as the sea. Said the shepherd boy to the mighty king, do you know what I know? In your palace warm, mighty king, the king to the people everywhere. Listen to what I say. Pray for peace, people everywhere. Listen to what I say. A child, sleeping in the night. Will bring us goodness and light. He will bring us goodness and light. A child, sleeping in the night. He will bring us goodness and light. He will bring us goodness.
Please be seated. Mary, did you know that your baby boy would one day walk on water? Mary, did you know that your baby boy would save our sons and daughters? Did you know that your baby boy has come to make you new? This child that you delivered will soon deliver you. Mary, did you know that your baby boy will give sight to a blind man? Mary, did you know that your baby boy will calm the storm with his hand? Did you know that your baby boy has walked where angels trod? When you kiss your little baby, then you kiss the face of God. Mary, did you know? Mary, did you know? The blind will see, the deaf will hear, the dead will live again, the lame will leap, the dumb will speak, the praises of the Lamb. Mary, did you know your baby boy is Lord of all creation? Mary, did you know that your baby boy will one day rule the nations? Did you know that your baby boy is heaven's perfect lamb? This sleeping child you're holding is the great I am. Mary, did you know?
Child is this who lay to rest on Mary's lap, is sleeping, whom angels greet with anthems sweet, while shepherds watch a keeping. Shepherds guide and angels sing. Nay, haste to bring him long, the babe, the son of Mary. Why lies he in a state where ox and ass are feeding?
Everybody could stand for this last song and sing.
And if the kids want to come out.
Come and behold him, O let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore in him, Christ the Lord. Oh, come, all ye faithful, joyful and triumphant. Oh, come ye, oh, come ye to
of the little ones. Father in heaven, we come before you this morning and we just give these little ones to you. I just pray that as they now go to their classes, that just let them feel love, peace, Lord. I just pray that by your Spirit, just talk to them, speak to them, draw them to you. We thank you for all that you have done, and now we just give these little ones to you and we just praise you for what you are going to do. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. 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 So as I'm getting this to try to work here, just want to do a prayer here. Got to word this the right way here. Just in the last 15 minutes, 20 minutes, there has just been a lot of spiritual warfare going on. And what that tells me is Satan doesn't want this message to go out. It has nothing to do with me, but it is the Word of God. And I just want to lift this service up. Also, there's just so many in our church are physically hurting, suffering. I just want to pray for them. And also, there's another individual that was brought to my attention that... she's not here with us, and God knows who she is, but just to pray for her safety and all that is going well. If you would, as a church, just pray with me. Father in heaven, we come before you, and this is your church. This is your service, and we just pray that you bind the enemy, and that what is said and what is heard is what you want to be said and heard. I just pray for all of those in our church, so many, just battling. They can't be here. They're fighting physical ailments. Just having a really hard time. We lift them up. You know who they are. We always pray. We always pray for healing in the name of Jesus. But if not so, that this draws them closer to you. And we lift up that one woman that was brought to my attention. We don't know where she is, but we just pray for her safety, her physical safety, and also just her spiritual safety. We just pray that you're with her. You're with her. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Amen. Thank you. I appreciate that. And believe it or not, I did much better this service with not crying like I did first service. I broke a little bit, but not much. But good morning for those that are here and for those who are watching online, live stream, or listening on the radio. I just want to welcome you to Calvary Chapel Grants Pass, where it is our desire to study the Word of God, to be able to live the Word of God, to be able to preach the Word of God to those unsaved, to the world, for what the world needs is Jesus. Please turn with me to the book of Acts. The book of Acts. On Wednesday, we finished chapter 27, but I'm going to pick it up, the last two verses of chapter 27. So please turn to the book of Acts, chapter 27, verse 43. Verse 43. But the centurion, wanting to save Paul, kept them from their purpose and commanded that those who could swim should jump overboard first and get to land, and the rest, some on boards and some on parts of the ship. And so it was that they all escaped safely to land. Now, chapter 28, verse 1. Now, when they had escaped, They then found out that the island was called Malta, and the natives showed us unusual kindness, for they kindled a fire and made us all welcome because of the rain that was falling and because of the cold. Verse 3. But when Paul had gathered a bundle of sticks and laid them on the fire, a viper came out because of the heat and fastened on his hand. So when the natives saw the creature hanging from his hand, they said to one another, "No doubt this man is a murderer, whom though he has escaped the sea, yet justice does not allow to live." Verse 5. But he shook off the creature into the fire and suffered no harm. However, they were expecting that he would swell up or suddenly fall down dead. But after they had looked for a long time and saw no harm come to him, they changed their minds and said that he was a god. Verse 7. In that region, there was an estate of the leading citizen of the island, whose name was Publius, who received us and entertained us courteously for 3 days. And it happened that the father of Publius lay sick of a fever and dysentery. Paul went into him and prayed, and he laid his hands on him and healed him. Verse 9, so when this was done, the rest of those on the island who had diseases also came and were healed. Verse 10, they also honored us in many ways, and when we departed, they provided such things as were necessary. Again, Father in heaven, we come before you, and we need to hear from you. I just pray that by your Holy Spirit, speak to each one of us here, to those watching, to those listening. Speak to us, each one of us, what we need to hear. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Amen. Verse 44 of chapter 27. But the centurion, wanting to save Paul, kept them from their purpose and commanded that those who could swim should jump overboard first and get to land. And the rest, some on boards and some on parts of the ship. And so it was that they all escaped safely to land. So the ship that they were on, it was close to land, but it was stuck between a sandbar and monstrous waves. And the soldiers, thinking that the prisoners were going to escape, the soldiers, to save their own lives, they were going to kill the prisoners. Roman law stated that if a prisoner escaped, the soldiers guarding those prisoners would have to forfeit their own lives. It was a life for a life. And a prisoner was counted dead or alive. So to the soldiers, hey, might as well kill them. So they moved in to kill the prisoners who they thought were going to escape. So the centurion, wanting to save Paul, remember Paul, he is a prisoner on this ship. Yes, he is favored, but he is still a prisoner. So the centurion, wanting to save Paul, he stopped the massacre and told all to try to make it to shore any way that they could, and some swam. Others used the broken pieces of the wooden ship being torn apart by the waves, and all on board made it to shore, all 276. And though it's not noted, I'm sure that Paul and Luke and Aristarchus, they gave a prayer of thanks. Thanks for all making it alive. It had been 2 weeks of terror that they had been in this typhoon-like storm. 2 weeks of terror had passed, but all 276 made it safely to shore. They all made it to solid ground. Verse 1 of chapter 28. Now when they had escaped, they then found out that the island was called Malta. Now the island of Malta was well known to sailors in the Mediterranean. Generally, they anchored their ships at the large harbor of Valletta. But as daybreak dawned, the sailors, they were not familiar with this part of the island of Malta. And the reason why is because it was on the opposite side of the harbor. Now, because Malta was inhabited mostly by Phoenician settlers, their language was a Phoenician dialect. And the name Malta was first given to the island by Phoenician sailors. The word derives from a Canaanite word meaning refuge. Hebrew is a subcategory in the only living Canaanite language. Paul, obviously knowing Hebrew, would have understood the island's name, the meaning of it. And to him and the others, how it bore true. Malta in Paul's day was ruled by Rome, and it was under the jurisdiction of the praetor, the governor of Sicily. And those on this island, it seems, were very hospitable. Verse 2. And the natives showed us unusual kindness, for they kindled a fire and made us all welcome, because of the rain that was falling and because of the cold. And the natives showed us unusual kindness. Natives, the Greek word is barbos. Just as Jews called all who were not Jews Gentiles, the Greeks patronizingly called all people who didn't speak Greek. If you remember, Greek was the language of the educated, of the intellect. So the Greeks called all people who didn't speak Greek barbos, or barbarians. Now, most Bible scholars believe Luke was Greek, and obviously he was educated. He was a doctor. Educated or not, these islanders somehow materialized from out of nowhere, and they showed great kindness to all of the 276. And these islanders, they lost no time in getting a good fire going to warm the ship's freezing castaways. Okay? The rain was still howling, driving, and the piercing cold, it reduced all to shivering survivors. And these shivering survivors, they were fortunate to have fallen into the hands of such kindly folk. Now, the Greek word for kindness is philanthropia. It is where we get our English word philanthropy. And the meaning is love of mankind, giving to others, benevolence. I am so blown away by the kindness, the philanthropia of this church. Over 80 children were blessed for Christmas by God through you, by you giving. The congregation of Calvary Chapel Grants Pass, listening to the Holy Spirit and the voice of God, benevolence, God's love in action. Verse 3. But when Paul had gathered a bundle of sticks and laid them on the fire, a viper came out because of the heat and fastened on his hand. So as usual, Paul, he made himself useful gathering sticks for the fire. Now, there could have been others doing the same from the 276. Scripture doesn't say. We do know that the natives, they kindled or lit the fire. And the Apostle Paul, he jumps right in, gathering sticks for the fire, and then laying them on top of the fire. See, he didn't rest on his laurels of saving the whole ship. He didn't play the fat cat leader and have others serve him. If anyone had the right to cruise, it was Paul. By his words of wisdom, led by the Holy Spirit, he saved all. He could have said, "Nah, I'm not going to do it. I've already done my bit. You guys serve me." No. He was right in there serving. Paul, a true leader, he dove into work serving others. The word leader, you may want to put supervisor, boss, whatever, is used as a noun, but it should be, in my book, a verb. To be a true leader, it requires action. A true leader should lead by example and care for those under his or her care. Jesus was the greatest servant of all. His whole life was one of servanthood. Here at Calvary Chapel, we try to emulate that example. The higher you get in leadership, that just means that you surrender and serve God more, and you serve the body more. This church is what is called an upside-down church, meaning that the top serves the bottom to the best of our ability. Paul was all about serving. Serving to glorify God. He didn't stand on his dignity nor plead exhaustion or fatigue. He didn't complain about the rain, the wind, the cold, nor fight for a place near the fire to warm himself. He just went out to get wood to keep the fire blazing for the benefit of others. By serving others, he was serving God. He was serving God. And when you serve God, Satan isn't happy. And there will be spiritual warfare. Satan, he will come at you hard, unexpected, with venomous hate. Try to discourage, divide, dissuade you, get you off track any way that he can as you try to be obedient to God. So be prepared. Understand that if you are serving God, and if you aren't and you're a believer, you should be. But be aware and be on your knees. Because if you're serving, Satan wants to take you down. He wants to make you ineffective in your ministry, whatever it may be. Your ministry could be your family, whatever it is. Where we do battle is on our knees, praying. And it was while serving that Paul had his encounter with the viper, the serpent. Now, the word viper in the Greek, it means offspring of vipers. The word here, offspring of vipers. Malignant. Wicked. Cunning. Now, this isn't the Greek word equivalent to the Hebrew word used for Satan or serpent in Genesis chapter 3, but the definition reminds me of Satan. Cunning. Malignant. Wicked, wanting to cause harm. And this viper sunk his teeth into Paul when Paul threw the sticks in the fire. The viper, the serpent, was hiding in the sticks in his service. Be aware. Currently on the island of Malta, supposedly there are no poisonous snakes. But one would expect over time that they could be easily exterminated. And nowhere in Scripture does it say that Paul drove out all of the snakes, as per some religious legends or myth. There's been all kind of discussion as to what kind of snake this was. And we don't really know, except that whatever it was poisonous, and its fangs fastened onto Paul's hand. The islanders, they had once recognized that this snake was poisonous. They knew, just looking at it. So to them, here was the end of Paul. He's doomed. To them, Paul had survived the storm and the shipwreck, now only to die by the fangs of a poisonous snake. Or so it seemed. Verse 4. So when the natives saw the creature hanging from his hand, they said to one another, "No doubt this man is a murderer, whom though he has escaped the sea, yet justice does not allow to live." This incident horrified those who saw it. The islanders, deep in Canaanite mysticism and Greek mythology, they already had an explanation. What one that could only have occurred to those who really didn't know Paul. See, they assumed that he was a murderer. See, he was a prisoner. So they assumed that he was a murderer. He'd escaped the shipwreck, but he would not escape the gods. Neptune, the god of the sea, had failed to take him. So Nemesis, the god of retribution and revenge, would. See, to them, it was a case of poetic justice. It doesn't say it in Scripture, but I can imagine Paul, who's understanding them, smiled when he heard what they were saying. He knew that neither one God nor the other had any power over him, nor did Satan. Paul knew that he was in God's hands. He had God's promise that he would make it, he would get to Rome. No power on earth nor in hell could refute that promise. This poisonous serpent could not harm him. to death. He was immortal until his work was done, and that work wouldn't be done until he preached the gospel to Caesar himself. So with the calm of a man shaking off a fly, Paul, he shook the snake into the fire and he went about his business, closely watched by all. Verse 5. But he shook off the creature into the fire and suffered no harm. Verse 6. However, they were expecting that he would swell up or suddenly fall down dead. But after they had looked for a long time and saw no harm come to him, they changed their minds and said that he was a god. So time passed, nothing happened. He didn't swell up like a balloon. He didn't keel over. Perhaps nobody watched more intently than Luke, Paul's personal doctor, physician. His services, even if offered, would not have been needed. Paul knew that this was to be one of those occasions spoken of by the Lord Jesus himself, not to be presumed upon, but valid during the transitional period covered by the book of Acts, where Scripture says in Mark chapter 16, picking it up in verse 15, Mark 16, verse 15, and he said to them, go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. He who believes and is baptized will be saved, but he who does not believe will be condemned. And these signs will follow those who believe. In my name, they will cast out demons. They will speak with new tongues. Verse 18, they will take up serpents with their hands. And if they drink anything deadly, it will by no means hurt them. They will lay hands on the sick and they will recover. They will recover. Now, I want you to understand that these promises are to be understood in the context of the dangers in the world while sharing, spreading the gospel of Jesus. Jesus never intended for believers to drink poison or to handle snakes, for it to be a specific test or measure of faith. No. And those who do, they are not glorifying God. And they have incorrect theology. To them, it's a gimmick, it's a ploy. And it's for self. The islanders here, they watched Paul with morbid interest. And when no ill effects manifested, they changed their minds. Paul wasn't a murderer anymore. He was now a god. Oh, but they were wrong again. Paul wasn't a murderer. And Paul, he wasn't a god. He was just a man. A man as God always intended man to be, continually in touch with God, inhabited and led by the Holy Spirit of God. Verse 7. In that region, there was an estate of the leading citizen of the island, whose name was Publius, who received us and entertained us courteously for 3 days. So the name Publius is generally taken to be an official title. This man was probably the Roman magistrate or the judge on the island. But the word, the definition of the word, it also means popular. Popular. He was well-liked. He was a popular guy. Either way, this guy had a large estate on the island near the shipwreck site. And he generously showed hospitality to the castaways, all 276 of them. And he was soon to discover that in ministering to Paul and the Christians, he was entertaining heaven's agents. And God is no debtor to any man. Nobody gives so much as a cup of water to one of his own without receiving a reward. God sees all. God sees all. Verse 8. And it happened that the father of Publius lay sick of a fever and dysentery. Paul went into him and prayed, and he laid his hands on him and healed him. And healed him. Luke, remember, he's a doctor. The physician, he took a professional interest in the symptoms of this man. And he must have gone in and diagnosed the man, or at least tried to. Now, this past year, my wife and I have seen a lot of medical doctors. All, it seems, experts in their fields. And for the most part, they all kind of disagree with each other's diagnosis or the cure. So often doctors can't figure it out. They can't nail down the problem. Like an auto mechanic working on a broken car. They are medical mechanics trying to rule this out, trying to rule that out, tinkering around, trying to figure out what's going on in the patient's body. Oftentimes they don't have a clue. And that is why it is called a medical practice. They are practicing at it. I'm not saying it's a negative. They don't know. They're trying. And oftentimes they are at a loss. Or if they do know, sometimes the cure hasn't been figured out yet. Here in chapter 28, the Greek word Luke used for fever, it is pouratas, and it is used in the plural. Elsewhere in the New Testament, when this word is used, it is usually in the singular. But here it conveys the severity of the sickness. There were different ailments going on in this man's body, plural. Now we know from history, back in the day, the Maltese were subject to a serious gastric fever caused by spoiled or infected goat milk. Whatever this man had, it was beyond Luke, beyond the medical cures of the day, and now clearly it became a case for Paul. So knowing that he was in the will of God, Paul, he gains access to the sick man, and with a word of prayer and laying of hands, heals him. The word means or denotes miraculously. It was a miracle. And the cure was immediate and complete. He didn't come back later complaining, well, the cure, it was imaginary. It wasn't a parlor trick. No, he was healed for good by God. And news spread quickly throughout the island. Verse 9. So when this was done, the rest of those on the island who had diseases also came and were healed. So as the word spread, Paul and his companions, they found themselves quite busy. People flocked in with the infirmed. Nothing like this had ever happened on the island before. Just imagine the former shipmates of Paul as they looked upon Paul, who had been such a tower of power and strength in their time of trouble, and now proving himself a healer, Paul a healer. No case was too hard, no one turned away. The Apostle Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, just like Jesus, healed the multitude. Matthew chapter 12, verse 15. Matthew 12:15. But when Jesus knew it, he withdrew from there, and great multitudes followed him, and he healed them all. Matthew chapter 14, verse 14. And when Jesus went out, he saw a great multitude, and he was moved with compassion for them and healed their sick. Matthew 19:2. And great multitudes followed him, and he healed them there. Matthew 21:14. Then the blind and the lame came to him in the temple, and he healed them. I can keep going on and on and on. There are so many verses of Jesus healing. Paul, led by the Holy Spirit, filled with the Spirit, he was healing. And this was also a joint effort in the spiritual battle by the believers. The word for healed in verse 9 is different than in verse 8. Verse 9, the word is therapeuo. Therapeuo. It's where we get our English word therapeutic, which means to do service, to restore, to cure. So not only was there laying on of hands manifesting the gift of healing, Luke the doctor was also involved in ministering his medical knowledge to the sick. And again, I'm sure there was a lot of prayer going on by the believers, all glorifying God and his goodness. As for today's healers, with their mass psychology, manipulative techniques, and quota of failures, we should be wary of them. Who do they glorify? Who do they glorify? God or them? Are they building up the kingdom of God, or are they lining their own pockets? A work of God and the Holy Spirit, it will always glorify God. A work of man, it will come back and glorify the man. No two ways about it. I don't want anyone to leave here saying, oh, that was a good message. I want people to leave here and say, you know what? I heard from God. It is nothing that I bring. I bring nothing to the table. It is the Holy Spirit. And that's what we pray for, that God speaks to us through His Spirit. Amen. That He is glorified. Not any man, not any church, but God. Jesus. Verse 10. They also honored us in many ways, and when we departed, they provided such things as were necessary. So Paul and his friends, they won their hearts. There was probably not a home on the island where they were not welcome. And the grateful natives showered them with honor and provisions, food, supplies needed to continue their trip. Remember, everything was lost during the shipwreck. And this whole period on the island had indeed been a refuge to Paul and his shipmates. The word refuge, it means shelter or protection from danger. We live in crazy times, and in all honesty, it's going to get even more crazier. This world is getting darker by the day. Jesus said in John chapter 8, verse 12, I am the light of the world. He who follows me shall not walk in darkness, but have the light of life. John 8, verse 12. But have the light of life. We have all sinned. All of us have sinned. And all of us are guilty. And the penalty for our sin, spiritual death, eternal death. But by believing in the name of Jesus, we can escape the coming judgment, the wrath. Jesus is our refuge. He gave His life so that we could live eternally. He forfeited His life for you, for me, for us. Hallelujah. Amen. Praise God. Come quickly. If you don't know Jesus as your Lord and Savior, I strongly encourage you to accept Jesus as your Savior and build your life on solid ground, on the rock of Jesus. I'm going to end today's message with Psalm 46. Psalm 46. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, even though the earth be removed, and though the mountains be carried into the midst of the sea, though its waters roar and be troubled, though the mountains shake with its swelling. Verse 4, there is a river whose streams shall make glad the city of God, the holy place of the tabernacle of the Most High. God is in the midst of her. She shall not be moved. God shall help her just at the break of dawn. The nations raged. The kingdoms were moved. He uttered His voice. The earth melted. Verse 7, the Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge. Selah. Verse 8, come behold the works of the Lord, who has made desolations in the earth. He makes wars cease to the end of the earth. He breaks the bow and cuts the spear in two. He burns the chariot in the fire. Verse 10, be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we come before you this morning. And I just thank you out of your love for us, benevolence. You gave us your Son. And Jesus, you came. You didn't have to. But you came. And out of love and faith and obedience, you lived a perfect life. And then you died a horrible death. You died for us so that we could live life for life. We thank you, Jesus. We thank you. I just pray for those that are in here that if there's someone who does not know Jesus as their Lord and Savior and would like to just slip up your hand. Or maybe you're watching and I can't see, but God sees. If you want that life insurance, slip up your hand. Jesus is just a prayer away, just a prayer away. Father in heaven, I pray by your Holy Spirit that you're just speaking to people, Lord. Or maybe there's some in here that have just been walking sideways and not following you, not being obedient. I just pray by your Spirit, draw them back to you. By your Holy Spirit, speak to each one of us in here, those watching, listening. Speak to us by your Spirit. And show us what we need to throw overboard, to be closer with you, to build our house on that rock. We just pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. If you would like prayer for any reason, please come forward. Myself and my wife will be here to pray with you. God bless.